For the husband who told his wife, "I love you," one last time before his plane went down. For the wife who stopped in the stairs to call her husband, to say, "I love you forever." For the mothers and fathers who kissed their kids goodbye that morning they died. For the police officers, firefighters, and medical personnel who rushed into the Twin Towers to help others only to die themselves. And to all who have lost their lives in the line of duty serving others since that tragic day 14 years ago. Know that on this Patriot Day, tomorrow, and for all enduring time, we will remember and honor your selfless acts of heroism. Because a history not remembered is a history repeated. This evening, on this Patriot Day, by whatever faith tradition we live, we gather in prayer as a community of democracy, duty, and dedication. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, whose great power and eternal wisdom gently and lovingly guides us, we thank you for the gift of life. We remember and honor the lives of men and women, heroes, who paid the ultimate sacrifice and have given their lives in the service of others. Our faith sometimes is more about trust than belief, more about hoping your ways have meaning and purpose for our lives than not. We know that good can come from evil, that your plan is far greater than our knowledge. So tonight we pray for the continued consolation of the families and friends of those who were permanently injured or died on that awful and horrific September 11th day. The civilians, the police officers, firefighters, EMS personnel, and all first responders, may what happened on our soil never happen again. We commit ourselves to living lives intent on treasuring the values of our country, life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. May your divine light protect all law enforcement officers, firefighters, first responders from harm in the performance of their duties. We commend them to your loving care because their work is often dangerous. We pray for their emotional and spiritual well-being. We pray for peace and joy in their homes and in this country. Bless all firefighters, law enforcement personnel, and first responders as they embark each day in a spirit of service upon their unique vocations, these, your sons and daughters. And as each day concludes, may they always return safely to their homes and loved ones. Direct all our actions by your holy inspiration and carry them out by your gracious assistance, so that every prayer and good work of ours may always begin from you, by you, and through you. And we say this in your holy name. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched, were so gallantly streaming. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave.
I want to welcome and thank you, everyone, for showing up tonight. This is the 14th anniversary of the day that the world stopped turning. I want to recognize all the state and local and state dignitaries that are here tonight. Also, I want to all the different first responders. I've seen the Border Patrol come up tonight. We have Oxford, Brandon, our own first responders here tonight, the Oakland County Sheriff's Department, and the Lake Orion Police Department. I also would like to thank the Veterans Memorial Committee for allowing us to be here tonight. They've graciously opened this up for us, and we appreciate it. I would probably forget to mention a few people, but I do want to especially mention Oxford and thanking them for bringing their aerial down so we can fly this flag above M24. So people coming north into our community, they know that we are patriotic. This year, I titled our theme, Passing the Torch, Patriotism Onto the Younger Generation. I brought a lot of the kids up here tonight. All these kids are children of first responders, grandchildren, and so forth. And so I want to give them a hand here, and they're going to sing a medley of songs for us before it's over tonight. 343 firefighters, 37 Port Authority, and 15 EMS personnel lost their lives 14 years ago. Unfortunately, almost half that number of first responders have lost their lives this year already. Some of it, and quite a bit of it's been in violence. Are we letting patriotism fade away? I hope not. Only this is why we need to be assured that the patriotic torch is passed on. The day after, September 12th, we collectively dusted ourselves off to begin to show patriotism, and it was as strong as it was ever witnessed. Young men and women stood in line to join forces to fight the evil. We have our own heroes that joined out of patriotism, and some came home and some haven't. We had Sergeant Plower, Sergeant Blaylock, that didn't make it home. They paid the ultimate sacrifice. With that, I would like to take just a couple minutes to talk about one of our other own. This story ties both patriotism and what the families of these first responders go through. This young man I have known most of his life. I have known his parents and siblings for the better part of 20 years. Army Captain Nicholas Stout joined the Army right after 9/11, and he served two tours, one in Iraq and one in Afghanistan. Thankfully, he returned home and now serves at the Pentagon. His parents are on the stage tonight, Assistant Chief Jeff Stout and his mother, Carol Stout. This couple is always thinking of the what ifs. Not only is Nick serving, but their daughter serves in the Border Patrol also. They always have apprehension when the phone rings and it's an unknown number. This is the life of families of first responders. But can you imagine for 1 minute getting a call from your daughter-in-law while you are on vacation and she tells you to watch the world news that your son, Nick, is going to be interviewed while he's in Afghanistan? As Jeff and Carol settled to watch their son as he was leading his team through a village being interviewed by a reporter, when all of a sudden they heard a shout of grenade. The cameraman dove. Everyone scattered. The outcome was good. It was a dud grenade. But can you imagine watching your loved one in harm's way that way? This is what families of first responders go through all the time. The beginning of this week, a firefighter from Lansing was out doing charity work collecting money. Let me say that again, just so everybody hears it correctly. He was out doing charity work when a young man became impatient because of his routine was interrupted, lost his cool, and ran this firefighter down. To make matters worse, and even sadder, this firefighter's wife was a critical care nurse working at the hospital where they took his torn body. He did not make it. It just isn't the individual's life that's lost, it's the families that are affected also. We must stop turning on our first responders and again turn our energy back to fighting the real evil. We must pass the torch of patriotism onto our young people so they know who the true enemy is. Tonight, I have a very special guest. This remarkable young lady at the age of 10 became upset at violence witnessed on the TV. Leah and her father, Judge Warren, Michael Warren, became instrumental in creating Patriot Week. She was only 10 years old when she started this, guys. She creating Patriot Week, and it is celebrated between 9/11 and 9/17 every year. Now she's a junior at Sehome High School. This honor student co-hosts and produces Patriot Lessons addressing American history and Patriot Week. And I want you to give her a round of applause. It's my pleasure to introduce Leah Warren.
Thank you so much for having me speak here today. It really is an honor. And I'm so thankful for all the young kids that came out today, people from all different ages. It's really special. Thank you. There's little doubt in my mind that everyone here over the age of 25, and even some a bit younger, would be able to tell you immediately what they were doing on 9/11. Some may have been sitting in a cubicle at work, typing away when the news announcement came on, and others were in school when suddenly they were sent home. Chances are, if you were 10 years old or older, you remember the catastrophic day of 9/11 very vividly. But on the other hand, there were a great number of us who were playing at daycare or still at cribs when the events unfolded. I'm among that generation, only 2 years old when the attacks took place. Although I've been raised to commemorate and always keep in mind the events of the past, many members of the younger generation neither remember nor care about the day that changed America's fundamental outlook on the world. For as long as I can remember, I've always had a great sense of pride in America. The ability to change the course of your life without being held back by your social class, endless opportunities, and a powerful and fairly recent history echoed the greatness of our country in my mind. Of course, part of this love of American history is due to my father, who is an avid studier of American history and a great patriot. And yet, it wasn't until about third grade that I was first introduced to the horrific events of 9/11. Although I remember nothing of the actual event, I remember very vividly sitting in class during the second week of third grade and being asked to respect a moment of silence on September 11th. At first, I must admit, I wasn't really sure what was going on. But later that day, I asked my teachers and peers. After having the event of 9/11 explained to me in the plainest of terms, I was shocked and confused, as any third grader would be if you were to tell them that terrorists hijacked a plane, flew into the World Trade Center and Pentagon, and caused the deaths of nearly 3,000 innocent civilians. After that point, I became very interested in the actual events. The timeline of the hijacking, how many people were on the plane, were there children, grandparents, or officials? How long did it take? Did the first responders know what was going on? Who responded? How many were saved that day? Who gave the ultimate sacrifice to save someone else? And overall, just why? I could never wrap my head around why these horrific events ever had to take place. Yet, it was on that day, when terrorists living in our midst caused terrible violence, we saw our true vulnerability as a nation. As I said earlier, so many of the population remembers 9/11 with extreme clarity. However, there is now a growing number of youth who only know the bare minimum about the event and the extreme effects it had in our society today. Some may even dare to say that we should move on from this tragedy and let it be forgotten with so many other aspects of our history into this dusty textbooks on the shelves. But we cannot let acts of terrorism ever be disregarded. It only happened 14 years from today, just over a decade. As George Santana once said, those who cannot remember the past are condemned to repeat it. All too often, America lets social media, celebrities, and gossip shadow the treasures and the tragedies of this great nation. As a country, and even more so as the youngest generation of this country, we need to make a commitment to remember the horrors of our past and ensure they never repeat again. We have made so many improvements in national security and surveillance, but unless Americans make an effort to remember and commemorate those events, the terrorists have already won. The biggest hurdle to overcome in order to ensure that 9/11 is never forgotten is to impress upon our youth that they cannot take their freedoms for granted. It's understandable why something that is so present in our daily lives could be easy to overlook and to accept as something that is permanent. But as the events of 9/11 remind us, there are always people in the world looking to take those freedoms away from us. The preservation of our freedom and the hope to renew the American spirit back into our citizens today is what motivated me to start Patriot Week. For those of you who are still a little bit unfamiliar with Patriot Week, it all started back in 2009 when I was just 10 years old. After realizing that Memorial Day was not actually created for carpet sales and a day off of school, but actually to commemorate our fallen heroes, my dad and I decided to start a week-long holiday. On each day of this holiday, we celebrate first principles from the Declaration of Independence, founding fathers, and other great patriots that made these principles come alive, key documents and speeches that embody those principles, and historic flags. The ideals of preserving our past in order to forge a better future are deeply rooted in Patriot Week's message. In the same way, those who perished on 9/11 must be commemorated. The heroes must be celebrated. And the passionate patriotism that invigorated America after the events must always be alive in our hearts. When I was a child, my parents made a point to tell me that only I can decide my future, and that my everyday actions will dictate it. In the same way, America's future is ours to decide. The people of this generation, the next, and the next, will decide whether or not we remember the pain of having our freedoms attacked, or turn it into the next national holiday celebrated with the day off of work and car sales. It's up to all of us, young and old alike, to make sure that this never becomes our destiny. The future of America lies in all of our hands. You have a choice. Walk away or join the fight. Thank you.
Wow, that's some powerful words. Our next speaker is a lifelong resident of Orion area. He graduated from Lake Orion High School in 1970. He started his long and dedicated career in law enforcement as a reserve with the Lake Orion Police Department. He moved on to, or he became full-time with the Lake Orion Police Department, and then he moved on to the Sheriff's Department, rising through the ranks as a detective and a fire investigator for the last 22 years. He's also proudly served his community as a member of the Orion Township Fire Department since 1983. Art Shiraw went to Ground Zero the day after the collapse of the Twin Towers. I now present you Art to give you a feel of what it was like to actually walk through the rubble.
Thank you, and first off, that's going to be a very tough act to follow. A young lady really did a great job. I'd like to take a few minutes and thank my friend and chief, Bob Smith, for giving me the opportunity to share my experience with you people today, and thank you everybody for coming today. The other thing I'd really like to do, and I'm probably going to pay a little bit for this, but I'd really like to publicly thank my wife, Kay Shiraw, for all the years that she has put up with me being on the fire department, and also being on the Sheriff's Department as a detective. You're subject to being called out numerous times, different hours, in the same way with the fire department. And a quick example of that is I was working midnights in Orion Township back in the late 80s, early 90s, on the midnight shift from midnight till 8 a.m. It was Christmas morning and I stopped home so the kids could open up their stockings. I had three boys, Nick, Jay, and Scott, were all at home. Went home, they opened them up, I went back to work, shift change came, I got home, and at 8:15 in the morning, I think the tone went off for a structure fire on Joslin Road. The kids were stuck at home, wait till I got home 2 or 3 hours later to open up the presents. This is what your first responders go through on a daily basis. And their wives, I'd like to thank, and girlfriends, thank all of them, because they put up with a lot of grief And most of the time, they don't give you any problem over it. They just accept it. They become the dad and the mom, and they take over. Thank you to all of you. I'd like to start off with 9/10/2001 was a normal day. I went into work at the Sheriff's Department, and upon reaching there, I was advised that myself and another detective were being sent up to the Upper Peninsula, up in Escanaba, to pick up a prisoner overnight and then return on 9/11. So we got up early in the morning, had breakfast, got over to the jail a few minutes before 9 o'clock, and walked into the jail to see several deputies standing in a small room watching a television. Walked inside to see that the first World Trade Tower had been struck by an airplane and was burning. We all stood there in disbelief, watched it for a few minutes, and shortly after 9 o'clock, the second plane flew into the towers. And at that time, we knew it wasn't an accident. We asked for our prisoner, loaded our prisoner up, and started heading back to Pontiac so we could get back to see what else was going to be going on within the Sheriff's Department. I know there's a lot of you that were here watching TV, listening to radios, and it was a full day of not knowing what was going on. There were a lot of reports being put out that turned out not to be true, but at that time they didn't know. They were having a hard time keeping track of aircraft, and they just weren't set up to be able to do things both ways. We got back to the Sheriff's Department approximately 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and to my surprise, the complex was actually barricaded. They had patrol cars and deputies standing out at any entrance into the Sheriff's Department because they weren't letting any cars near any part of that. I believe they were doing that to the other buildings too, the Circuit Court building. Everybody was in fear. Nobody knew what was going to happen, and they weren't taking any chance that we were going to be in any attacks in Pontiac. Upon arriving back there, we had to show them our ID. They let us into the gate, and we parked, and I was told to report to the training sergeant down in the basement of the jail because they were putting a group of police officers from the Sheriff's Department to deploy to the Trade Center to New York that night. I went down and spoke with the sergeant, and the reason I was picked to go is because I had firefighting background, I had fire investigation background, and also law enforcement background for many years. I accepted the position to go, and like I said again, back then I didn't have a cell phone, so my wife's home alone, not having anything, and I've already made a commitment that really she doesn't even know about yet. So she's been going through all this, and I get home, and what she do? She's running around trying to help me pack. In fact, she's telling me you should lay down and get a nap, because if you're gonna be up all night, you need some sleep. And so we packed together, and I got ready waiting a phone call to go back down to the Sheriff's Department, which I got a call around 7 o'clock that said we were to be down there at 9 o'clock, packed for at least 7 or 8 days. We went down, stowed our gear, and they also had a semi-trailer there that the sheriff had put out the word over the media for all the citizens that had non-perishable products, water, canned goods, clothing, blankets, anything that they could to bring it to the Sheriff's Department. And we had an individual that donated his tractor and trailer, plus he would drive it to New York City. So by 11 o'clock that night, we had the trailer pretty much loaded, and we packed up and started going in a caravan along with officers from Auburn Hills, Royal Oak, and the Lake Angeles Police Department. Those were the four main departments that headed for Ground Zero. We drove all night. In fact, going across the turnpike in Ohio, the first one we got to, we stopped at it for the toll and told them where they were going and how many patrol cars we had, and they were calling ahead. So every toll booth was waving us through. They weren't even slowing us down, including the semi. And we made it to New York, New Jersey, just before noon the next day. And after going through various checkpoints, security checkpoints, we were advised to head to New York Giants Stadium, where they were taking all the first responders that were responding in, putting them there to get them deployed to different areas in New York City. Like I said, we arrived at the stadium around noon and spent the day there till probably 6 or 7 o'clock at night. And then we were advised that that day that they weren't going to be sending anybody else over. And so there was a motel that was right close to it. We ended up spending the night in a motel there, and we're back at Giant Stadium at 8 o'clock the next morning. When we arrived at 8 o'clock the next morning, we were approached, our commanders were, there were 24 officers total, including command officers from the four departments I mentioned that went. And they came up to us and they said, we've got a detail and we don't know if you guys are going to want to do it because it's been offered to other groups and they're really not interested. They said, we're getting a whole bunch of garbage that's being dumped into a hangar over at the airport in New York, and we need people to go through it and check all this garbage for evidence. And they got the group together and we said, absolutely, anything they need over here, we're willing to do. We really didn't care what it was. So we loaded up and got escorted over to the airport. And that was a little bit different too when you get to the airport, because all the entrances to the airport are guarded by military personnel with automatic rifles. And it's not something that, even myself and law enforcement, it's not something that I'm used to seeing. And we had to show our credentials. They escorted us in and we got to the hangar, and there was just mounds and mounds and mounds of it. And before we got started, they came up to us and said, we canceled all our police academies and we've brought over several hundred recruits, and we've got our recruits from the police department that are gonna go through the garbage. And you guys, we want you to go to Liberty Park on the Hudson River and get with the New Jersey State Police there for another deployment. Just as a note on that, and I'm sure that some of you have read about it, but within that garbage, they located numerous amounts of evidence. Most of that garbage was taken from hotels in New Jersey, and they came up with a lot of documents that were in Arabic that were actually from the hijackers, and that's how they identified a lot of them, was from that the material they were getting and the different fake ID that they were found that was thrown away and they pulled out of the landfills. So we get over to Liberty Park, which is actually right across the Hudson River from ground zero. And as we get over there, the New Jersey State Police has a police boat, and they're actually transporting some of the troopers over to relieve other troopers at ground zero. And they said they had room, and they had room for four of us to go with them, and I was fortunate enough to be one of the four. They got to board the boat and they took us across the Hudson River. All I can tell you is just going across the river, the plume of smoke coming up from ground zero was something that I've never seen before. And this is days after actually the towers went down. When we got to Giant Stadium, have you ever seen it on TV? At the old stadium had the spiral walkways on the outside. And we actually got up to the top of the walkways and would look across, and we could see ground zero and the smoke coming up. And that was quite a few miles away. So we got in a boat, we docked at the docks by the Trade Center and got off the boat, and they said, hey, we're gonna be here for about 45 minutes, so feel free, go on and walk around, take a look at what's going on over there, and then be back here at a certain time for the boat, or you know, you're gonna find a different way back. So when we got off of the boat, we started walking across the grass between the docks and where ground zero, the outside of it had been. It was amazing because there was 4 to 5 to 6 inches of gray dust. And every time you would walk, it would kick up a cloud. And it's kind of like, for those who are old enough to remember it, a Peanuts cartoon where you had a character in there that they walked, they called him Pigpen. And that's all I could think of, is because every time you stepped, the cloud would come up. And just from walking through there, your pants up above the knees would be turned gray when you'd be coming back out. And we walked around, and we're able to walk into the one area that was an entranceway. It was just where they had a void where they could get in. Probably was a street going into ground zero that wasn't full of debris. And we were able to walk into part of ground zero. And as soon as you walked in, it was just totally mind-boggling to me, because you're seeing an area. You talk about ground zero. Ground zero was the World Trade Center set on 16 acres of land. If you can stop and think of that, just looking around, 16 acres of land. A lot of people, if they've got a good sized lot, they've got a half an acre. So if you multiply that times 32, and that's the area that's just covered with debris where the Trade Center used to be, and you're walking in and there's piles of debris that are 7-8 stories high, and you've got firefighters, rescue workers, police officers, and they almost look like little ants. They're so far away and they're up on top of these piles of debris. They're climbing up beams and they're walking around searching for everything. Shortly after we walked in, we could hear some of the firefighters yelling, we've got some live ones. And everybody in that area stopped, and I probably had 4 firefighters walk past me covered with debris, probably about 8 feet away. And I found out later, they were the four that got rescued, but they weren't from the original collapse. They were actually in a vehicle and they were going under one of the walkways that used to connect a lot of the trade centers and the buildings around there. And the walkway collapsed, pinning them under debris, under their vehicle. And they'd been in there for several hours and they were rescued and they were okay. Walking through Ground Zero, the smoke, you'd look at all the crevices, you could see fire coming out. This is actually on the 13th, I think, was the first day that we got in there. Because the 11th, we drove all night. The 12th, we were at Giant Stadium. The 13th, we walked in. A lot of smoke coming out. The odors from all the smoke. The firefighters and workers, you could tell by looking at them, there were a lot of them that probably hadn't been sleeping in days. Their bunker coats, their pants were completely covered with dust. And you could tell that they tried to wash themselves off numerous times. They were dedicated people, and the expressions on their faces were just very solemn. And they had a job to do, and they were doing it. We ended up going back to the boat, and upon getting back to New Jersey, we were advised that we were being deployed into New York City, and we were being assigned to assist the FBI with the collection of airplane parts and any other evidence from passengers that could have been aboard the airplanes at the time of the crashes. We were assigned by the FBI and told that we were going to be working 12-hour shifts for the entire time we were there. We had a 24-member team, so they divided our team into two teams, so two 12-man teams. We had a captain that stayed with one group and a lieutenant that went to the midnight shift and stayed with the other. The shifts were 7 a.m. till 7 p.m., or you work 7 p.m. till 7 a.m. I fortunately was able to work the day shift. What we would do at Ground Zero is we would always leave six individuals back at the command post. The command post at the Sheriff's Department, if you're not familiar with it, was a very large vehicle that was equipped with a lot of different computers, a lot of different equipment that we needed in there, and it also was one of the first ones that had a satellite phone on it. And the one thing about Ground Zero that if you talk to anybody in that area, one of the reasons they had a lot of problems with communications was probably 80% of their cell phone towers were on top of the trade centers. So when they came down, there were no cell towers in that area. So the cell phones were as good as boat anchors. And there were numerous times that there would be individuals that would have to, and we were allowed every couple of days to use a satellite phone just to call home and let them know we're doing okay and to keep our loved ones abreast of what was going on. We would keep six individuals there for the FBI. The other six individuals would walk down into Ground Zero and would take part and join on the Bucket Brigade. And for those of you, and especially for our younger people that are here, and I don't know if you've seen it on TV and you're probably wondering, what's a bucket brigade? Well, a bucket brigade actually, a long time ago, was used by firefighters. They used to fill up buckets of water and pass them up because they didn't have fire trucks and big pumps that had all the water there. There were no fire hydrants. So that's how they would get the water on the fire. Down at Ground Zero, you'd walk in and there'd be groups of rescue workers, and they could be anywhere from 50 to several hundred people long, going from the center part of Ground Zero where the debris was being dug, and they would hand dig the debris, put it into a 5-gallon plastic bucket, and they would hand the bucket back to the individual behind them until the buckets would get all the way to the end of the line, and that individual would dump it into a pile that was out there, and then heavy equipment would come through and scoop up the debris and then take it to another holding area. And ultimately, this debris was loaded on barges and taken over to another area, an island, where they went through it again and they gathered a lot more evidence that was missed out of it originally. A lot of the different things that would go on in Ground Zero is they had the Army Corps of Engineers within Ground Zero because a lot of the different buildings around there weren't stable, the buildings that were in partial collapse. And so the Corps of Engineers would set on these buildings and they'd have transits that would be set up on the building. So if that building moved a millimeter of an inch, they would sound an alarm. They had an alarm system in Ground Zero that was actually a series of horns that would blow off. And because of the debris in Ground Zero, there was actually only three ways in and three ways out. And these were actually roads or areas where the debris had been cleared so they could get the heavy equipment in. So there's only three ways in and three ways out. And the scariest part was these alarms would go off on a daily basis, several times a day. And the workers within Ground Zero were supposed to, as soon as the alarm went off, you were to get out of Ground Zero ASAP, as soon as possible. You would drop what you're doing and you get out of there because you never know what's happening. The worst part was as volunteers, we didn't know if you're running towards the possible collapse or if you're running away from it. Because the area you're working in, there might only be one way out. And when the alarm goes off, you're walking, running there, and you don't know if that's the building that might be collapsing or not. And everyone would get out, then they'd sound the all clear, and the people would head back in. The other thing within Ground Zero that would take place is whenever any human remains were found within Ground Zero, the work in that area was stopped. They would try to, if they could identify it, whether it was a law enforcement officer or a firefighter, and that's if they could tell by the uniform they were wearing, then what they would do is once they had the body, they identified the body, then they would go and notify either the fire department if it was fire personnel, or the law enforcement if it was Port Authority, or whether it was the New York City Police Department. And then what they would do is try to get members of that group to go in there, and then they would go in, and when they went in to recover the body, all work within Ground Zero would stop. And they would escort their own comrade out of Ground Zero into a waiting ambulance to take him away. I want to share one little experience that I had. And if I don't have any regrets for serving at 9/11. However, it was a life-altering experience. I had the opportunity to meet after shift while sharing a beverage with the other officers near our hotel. There was an individual that walked up to me and approached me, and he asked me, "Are you a New York firefighter?" Because a lot of us were wearing New York firefighter t-shirts and New York City police officers shirts, t-shirts. And he walked up and I explained to him, I said, "No, I'm from Michigan." I said, "I'm here at Ground Zero helping them." And he said, "Do you mind if I sit down and talk to you for a few minutes?" And I said, "No, not at all." And he went on and he told me that his father worked within the Port Authority and worked in the World Trade Center. In fact, he was one of the maintenance supervisors. And he told me, he went on and he told me he hadn't heard from his father in 5 days, but he was sure his dad was okay. Because his father was also in the World Trade Center in 1993 when they blew up the truck bomb in the basement. And his dad refused to leave the World Trade Center until he helped everybody out of that building. Now, the whole time he's talking to me, I can only imagine that I know he's got faith, but I'm not thinking it's really that good because it's been probably 4 or 5 days since the towers went down. We spoke and he wanted to keep talking, and his family made numerous trips up and said, "Come on, let leave the man alone. He's been working all day. He doesn't need to talk to you." And I said, "No, he's fine." I ended up staying there till about closing time that night, till it was time to close and he had to leave. And he told me, he thanked me and shook my hand. And before he left, I gave him my business card. And I said, "Do me a favor." I said, "When you hear from your dad, give me a call." And I've never gotten that phone call. I'm a person with a type A personality. I'm normally not lost for words, as anybody I've worked with can tell you, and can quick to be jumped to conclusions at any time. Upon returning from Ground Zero, the small things in life didn't matter to me. It took several months for me to get back to my normal self, if that's a good thing. But normally when people would cut me off in the road, I would get angry. I do that to this day. My wife's always saying, you know, knock it off. But that's how I am. But when I got back, those things didn't matter anymore. Somebody cut me off, I'd just wave to it. And I'd wave with my whole hand. But things will change, and there's a lot of things that happen. And real quick, I just want to share, before I close, a few facts. At 8:45 on 9/11, the North Tower was attacked. At 9:03, the South Tower was attacked. At 9:45, the Pentagon was attacked. At 9:59, the South Tower collapsed. At 10:10, flight number 93 went down in Pennsylvania. And at 10:28, the North Tower collapsed. The victims that died in these disasters, 246 citizens died in the aircraft. 22,262 civilians died within the buildings. 55 military personnel were killed. 343 firefighters and 71 law enforcement officers. That's a total of 2,977 victims, and that's not counting the 19 perpetrators. In closing, the real heroes in the city of New York were the firefighters and police officers who responded to the call of help from those trapped within the World Trade Center. They were those employees who chose to remain within the building to help other workers escape. They were the victims at the Pentagon and those brave individuals who took a stand against the terrorists and crashed in Shanksville, Pennsylvania. So please remember that as time passes and helps heal all losses, do not forget. Thank you.
Now I'm gonna ask Post Commander Jim Hubbard up now. He wants to make a presentation. Oh, there he is back there. Jim Hubbard from the VFW Post 334.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. But more importantly, good evening, comrades. That's a term that the VFW uses quite often. And in this case, I think we all are comrades. The country is in dire need of patriotism. And before I present this award tonight, I would just like to give you a little bit of a background about the award. Since 9/11, the Veterans of Foreign Wars decided we needed to do something to show our support to our brothers in arms, our police officers, our firefighters, our paramedics that come running all the time to help us. And so they came up with this award. It's a national award. We gave one away last year, but just a little statistics. In the state of Michigan, there's 297 posts. In the national organization, there's 14,640 posts. Everybody turns in nominees. We're very fortunate to have two in the row. I just can't believe that this happened to our post, but it makes me so proud to be able to stand here and pass out an award to someone tonight. Nationally, he was elected. I didn't have anything to do with it. It's sent away and voted on. And this year, I like to make a presentation. It says, the VFW National Policeman's Public Service Citation Award winner, 2014-2015, Lake Orion Police Department's Lieutenant Harold Rossman. Yes. Thank you for your service, sir. And our community is blessed with all these wonderful men and women that step forward every year. I would like to say thank you to the VFW, my family, all my first responder partners for this award. Couldn't do it without all of you. And it's a little bittersweet today getting it, since we're the 14th year remembering of the biggest tragedy that we've had in the United States. But again, thank you all. And thanks again for the VFW. I would just like to thank everybody for coming here this evening. It's just a wonderful occasion that we have an opportunity to do things like this. Thank you.
Thank you, Jim. All right, we're going to have a highlight of the evening. All the children, would you please come up on stage here? The children are going to sing a medley of songs for you.
Thank you, everyone, for attending tonight. I want to first thank everyone for all the comments. On behalf of all public safety and our veterans, the fire, police, emergency medical services, all those kind comments that we receive when we're out in the community, it's very gratifying to us. Keep it coming. We really appreciate that. We want you to personally know that we have your backs when you go to sleep at night, 24/7, all the holidays. We're always there for you. Your support is critical to our mission and what we do. So please keep us in your thoughts, and we're always going to be there for you. As we draw the ceremony to a close, I want to share some final thoughts on why this date is so important in American history. The American spirit that was so overwhelmingly displayed for the world to witness on September 11, 2011, has come to symbolize the selfless American spirit that at times is hard to put into words, but we know when we see it, and we know when we feel it. It looks like Americans in uniform rushing into the Twin Towers as they're coming down. It looks like Americans in blue jeans, suits, and military uniforms helping the injured out of the collapsed Pentagon. It looks like flight attendants, salespeople, skilled trades aboard 911 who refused to sit down, but instead let loose with that selfless American spirit that saves thousands of lives. This kind of brave American spirit was inherent, and it came natural because many of those folks really didn't have time to think about it, they just did it. Today it looks like three young, brave, unarmed Americans on a crowded French train that stopped the latest mass murder. We are very proud to see and feel that same American spirit gathered here tonight. And yes, we paused on September 11, 2001. And hopefully we're going to pause every September 11th as we pay this forward like all those people before us did. I want to thank you for coming out tonight.
On that September day, for you in the yard,
as we listen to this song tonight, I'd like to have everybody stand up and turn towards M24 because you're missing a beautiful sight. You're seeing the American flag flying over M24.
Rejoice for the people who walk from the rubble, and sorrow for the ones left below. Did you burst out with pride for the red, white, and blue, and the heroes who died just doing what they do? Did you look up to heaven for some kind of answer, and look at yourself and what really matters? I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things He gave us. Greatest is love. Where were you when the world stopped turning that September day? Teaching a class full of innocent children, driving down some cold and stone. Did you feel guilty cause you're a survivor? In a crowded room, did you feel alone? Did you call up your mother and tell her you loved her? Did you dust off that Bible at home? Did you open your eyes, hope it never happened? Close your eyes and not go to sleep. Did you notice the sunset the first time in ages? Speak to some stranger on the street. Did you lay down at night, think of tomorrow, go out and buy you a gun? Did you turn off that violent old man? to a church and hold hands with some strangers. Stand in line and give your own blood. Did you just stay home and cling tight to your family? Thank God you had somebody to love. I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. Faith, hope, and love are some good things He gave us, and the greatest is love. I'm just a singer of simple songs. I'm not a real political man. I watch CNN, but I'm not sure I can tell you the difference in Iraq and Iran. But I know Jesus, and I talk to God, and I remember this from when I was young. And the greatest is love. And the greatest is love. Where were you when the world stopped turning on that September day?
If you remain standing, I'm going to ask Reverend Dennis Emmons from Lake Orion Police Department to give us our closing benediction.
Thank you, Chief. Please join me in a closing prayer. Father God, as we end this Patriotic Day ceremony, we're once again reminded how truly great our country is, and what makes it great are the freedoms and liberties which we all share. Thank you for the host of patriots who have dedicated their lives to protect these freedoms and liberties. Thank you for the fact that they go into harm's way every day to protect our continued freedom, like those on September 11, 2001. God, please bless them, and please bless our nation. I pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Everybody attend hut. Salute. Thank you again, everybody, for coming tonight. I really appreciate it. The first responders really appreciate that you showed up tonight to show your support for 9/11.
September day.